Good evening and welcome to this edition of A Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. Thank you very much for keeping it Urban TV. We hope out there you're sanitizing. We hope you're wearing your mask. We hope you're social distancing because COVID-19 is still ravaging our society and it is real. It does kill. If you're amongst the categories of Ugandans that have been identified by the government of Uganda for vaccination, please go and do take your jab. Our guest tonight is a member of parliament representing Masaka municipality in the 10th parliament. He was re-elected for the third term running as the newly elected MP for Nyendo Mukungwe City. He is a teacher and a politician. Honorable Matthias Mpuga Nsamba, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Nicholas.
Honorable, I'll begin by asking you, would you rather be preferred to as a honorable or HTVA? Because I've been told that those are two distinct titles.
Well, but I would prefer to call me the original title, and it rarely fades, HTVA. So the politicals and the social like you prefer the honorable title, but I'll gladly take either.
So I'll interchangeably use them during our time on the set. Honorable, welcome back from the National Unity Platform retreat that happened in Jinja.
Thank you.
I would add in welcoming you that you deciding to go for a retreat with newly elected MPs, mayors from different areas and LC5 chairpersons effectively means that you're conceding defeat and taking up your position as the official opposition political party in Uganda.
Well, Nicholas and viewers, let it be very clear. We have been unequivocal in informing our supporters, our followers, that changing a regime of 35 years, coming to 40, is never an event. It's not an event, it's not a party, it is real a long haul, and we are in for the long haul. We regard the next parliament, the next parliament which we shall participate, as one such stage in which we continue our quest to see a better Uganda. Call it conceding, call it changing tact, call it whatever you want to call it. We are in for a long haul. So the description is a mere matter of nomenclature. We are in for a long haul.
What do you mean when you say you're in for a long haul? Because what I'm asking is that we've been here in 2016. Actually, there was a debate in the media on whether we should have a leader of opposition in parliament or a minority leader. And all this was stemming from then the opposition leader, the Forum for Democratic Change, not conceding that they were defeated, but in actual sense, participating in a process in which they were defeated.
I wouldn't delve into minority versus leader of opposition. It's all a question of wastage of space and mere academic. What is not in doubt is that there's a job to do. Whether an election is stolen or not stolen, there's a job to do, because the trajectory of this country is the wrong trajectory. And whether we seek to say the election was stolen and therefore we are not participating, so we choose to go and hang, we choose to go and prostrate before Gen. Museveni, then we choose to go and tell our people to cry on top of hills. No, we hesitate to take firmer measures. We'd rather be positive. We decided that as NUP, the whole world saw what happened. Gen. Museveni and his people actually are aware of what they did. We're not suicidal. We know our game. We shall not play the game of our enemy. We set our game, and it's the only game we shall play. So we are not into talking about what the FDC did or failed to do. We are different. They had their way, and I think they succeeded their way. We cannot call them failures in what they chose to do. we have decided to tackle the problem the NUP way. And part of our way is that we shall be in the 11th Parliament and do our job as politicians, as political leaders, seeking to change the political trajectory of this country. And we know for a fact that once you fix the political stupid, as the Americans want to call it, then now you can fix the rest of the problem. So we aim to fix the problem over the long haul. It can take us the next 1 week, it can take us the next 50 days, 100 days, a year or two, it will happen. But for that to happen, we must keep the business. We shall change things, we shall work on things while we are in the field, not in abeyance.
I'm going to insist on the argument, and by juxtaposing two scenarios between 1996 and 2021, we've had the same scenarios. We've had a repeat of events. In 1980, on the contrary, the Democratic Party, your mother party, decided to take up seats in Parliament, and at the end of the day, we saw many of the supporters and members of that party along the 5 years crossing over to UPC. UPM, that had one MP in the names of Crispus Chiyonga, did not take up their seat. They decided to wage a protracted struggle. The rest is history. Don't you think you're trailing on a very slippery path that other colleagues have taken and have failed? Yet you have lessons of history
For the record, we are not UPM and we are not DP. We are NUP. We are reading nobody's notes. We have our own script. We authored that script. We shall follow our script. Not that we are oblivious of our history. In fact, our script is partly informed by our checkered history. And therefore, we chose to pursue our own script, not because we are oblivious of what history teaches us. In fact, in following our script, we are trying as much as feasible to avoid our checkered history. The NRM and its choice under UPM then does not represent smart history. You know, killing people and jumping over people's heads to partake of power does not represent smartness per se. It's actually, for me, an act of failure to think beyond emotions. So we are emotional, but we are able to drive our agenda without necessarily using the same tools that we do not think are democratic tools to partake of power. We have our space. We know where that space is. We are going to push for that space and nothing but that space. Once we are able to seize that space, we can surmount every obstacle in our way.
What do you plan to do differently as a political party, considering that you're saying you're not DP, you're not NUP, albeit the fact that you're the same players, you're the Honorable Mpuga that was an independent in 2011, a DP in 2016, now an NUP. You're the same players. So what are you going to do differently?
What would you do if you were a player in a team in which you were a goalkeeper and you are made a striker? Would you strike with your hands? So we are the same people playing a different game. And read my lips, we know what we are doing. And I was independent hitherto, absolutely. And if you checked the reason why I was, you can understand the kind of game some of us are up to. When we jumped ship out of the sinking boat of DP, it's not that we're not alive to the possibilities. In fact, some people called us suicide bombers because we nominated on a party on the blink of being deregistered. But because our agenda was a clear agenda, that we wanted to do things different, we do them different. I think you need to give us time without being preemptive to see how we're going to work differently. We keep quite bulk of our cards up close to our chests because we work in a very, very difficult political environment, laden with all manner of banter, laden with all sorts of espionage. We'd rather be given time to real form up what we are trying to do, and we believe what we are trying to do is good for the country. We are quite alive to the kind of duty we owe this country. But most importantly, we are alive to the nature of duty we owe this generation. The generation that voted us and rejected Yoweri Museveni with all his machinations. We are alive to the obligations and we are going to pursue that duty without any iota of contradiction.
Talking about the mere fact that you're alive to the generation that does support you, that then begs the question of how were you able to dislodge? Was it a wave? Was it luck? Or was it a strategy that you were able to dislodge a ruling party from its political base? Because take it or leave it, Buganda is NRM's political base. It waged its war here. It has always gotten the majority of its supporters here.
Call it a strategy or a tragedy. I think a strategy collided with a tragedy. A tragedy of a sleepy regime, a regime properly disconnected with the population. And because we were prepared, we struck. And when we struck, the regime did not master a response. You could see their response after the election was brutality, murder, abductions, disappearances. There's no amount of luck that will miss preparedness. I think it was a coincidence of luck finding the prepared. I'm very sure you were following us, Smart Journal. You were following our meetings. Some of us have been to this for the last more than 20 years. I am 45. I began the struggle for a better country when I was a young man at 19 years at the university. And I have never looked back. If you make an enumeration and a catalogue who is who among the seniors in NUP, you'll discover that the bulk of them form that group that have been very consistent in pursuing particular values, in demanding for particular political discourse in this country. And they form the bulk of the seniors in NUP. So I must confess that we did some good planning. Of course, first with a huge juggernaut of a state party, which we had to surmount. So whoever calls it a whirlwind, why had this same whirlwind blown elsewhere? You know? Suddenly, the NRM, in particular Yoweri Museveni, calls Buganda his maker. So what happens to a maker that you have abandoned for a bush, that you have abandoned in terms of outlook? I had an up-close conversation with somebody, probably knowledgeable with the workings of Yoweri Museveni. He told me that Yoweri Museveni works like Stalin, you know? So to discourage people from fighting him and going to the bush to pursue his route, he's made sure that Buganda is starved such that nobody ever picks up the appetite to support rebellion. So to the people of Luwero, they are paying for supporting rebellion because Yoweri Museveni must kill the appetite by making Luwero and surroundings impoverished that nobody ever supports rebellion. So to answer you more aptly, we were prepared. Okay, of course, we also encountered a few surprises, namely that we were not able to get over 20 MPs from Busoga. The president won in Busoga.
That's what I was going and I was
by
about
over
to
70%.
You,
so
I was going to ask you, don't you fear you're going to be looked at as a Uganda party?
No, that is far-fetched. Every party has a base. And if you have no base, then you're a floater. We don't want to build NUP as a floater. We want to give this party a base. The party must have a home. I am very sure, I'm not sure whether you are married. Are you?
I will be.
You will be, certainly. I'm sure if you're on a search, you're not searching for a girl on the street. Even if you met one, you'd ask where is home, okay? Because you really want to establish whether this person has values. So the party has a base. and they should, there's no apology. We owe nobody an apology for giving this party a base. But mark you, party bases shift. I'm very sure now if asked Genome 7, he would tell you now the NRM base is in Elangwa and Acholi. Because we have since upstaged his quarter guard in Buganda. So if you are going to build a formidable organization, you must give that organization a base. And we figured out where Genome 7 and his people had anchored. They had set base in Buganda, sown seeds of confusion. We uprooted them and threw them into the political tall grass.
That draws me to the question of the Buganda question. If you follow political history, it has always been at the center of our elections and all struggles. What should we do for Buganda? What should we do to appease Buganda? As a former minister of the kingdom, man, don't you think what was perceived as Buganda wields and its people has been demystified now that I know I can govern Uganda without necessarily the support of Buganda? And where does that leave your interests as a kingdom then?
I think we are mixing multiple issues. One, the Buganda question is not per se an inward looking question. The Buganda question is a question of fairness. The Buganda question is a question of justice. It's not a question of wishing to be superior. The innuendos about Buganda wanting to be different are the innuendos propagated by the detractors. Buganda wants justice. Tell me which part of Uganda would love to really be segregated. Which part of Uganda wants to be exploited? I think the only difference is that Buganda is positioned, luckily, in such a way that information is more accessible here. People in Buganda, because of access to information, easily are able to demand. Secondly, because again in Buganda, people have access to more education and therefore enlightenment, probably as is that of history. So the quest for Buganda is a question for justice in the entire Uganda. And therefore, it will not place Buganda in a disadvantaged position when the rest of Uganda gets justice. In fact, Buganda will be a beneficiary out of a system that will propagate justice, that will propagate fairness in the sharing of national resources and in the dispensation of whatever we quest for as a people. So I do not see any problem. The only distinction now that the political class in Uganda have also want to really partake of power and direct things, call it taking matters in their own hands. If the demand was for other people to grant, they are now moving in another state to take matters in their hands.
I'll come back to the Uganda question a bit later, but I'm weighed down by the question of when you look at political parties in Uganda per se, all of them, you realize that one of the things that has weighed them down has been internal political party contradictions, and these political parties not knowing how to manage those internal contradictions, albeit one of the reasons as to why you jump shipped the Democratic Party to the National Unity Platform was because you failed to agree with the leadership there internally. One then wonders, what if these contradictions crop up in the NUP? How are you going to deal with these contradictions? Today, your friends in the FDC have a splinter. You can't call it a splinter group, but out of a result of failing to manage internal contradictions, you have now the Alliance for National Transformation. How are you going to deal with this as the National Unity Platform?
For the record, we did not leave the DP because we failed to agree. There was actually even no platform for that disagreement to take place. The president of the party and a small clique simply hid themselves. We could not access them. So we didn't have a platform to disagree. It never was. So I don't know where they are. We didn't know what they were doing. They just hid themselves somewhere. So we could not access them. So we needed a home where our ideas could be accommodated. That said, the contradictions in the parties are born out of failure to confront the emerging issues. I think party leaders are normally shy to open up to the conversation and the realities that confront them. And I would invite any organization wishing to be a political party to always be open to discussing contradictions. If they are ideological, they need to confront them and cultivate a common platform to which they will recruit members, to which they will mobilize citizens to participate. If you have multiple ideological orientations, suddenly, as a matter of history and as a matter of time, you will collide. So, if there are honest conversations in these parties, these splinter groups will not arise. For the bigger part, for the much that I know, they are normally premised on failure to agree on a critical path as parties. As to whether they are personal, that's a different matter. And I never at any one time do politics with an individual because of my personal relationship. I have drivers that are ideological in nature that I follow. And once we are able to agree on the most important thing, direction of the party, then I can fit in any party that works my path.
I would say at the birth of the NUP, your challenged with these very same contradictions, and I don't hear you speak to this. I'll give you an example. Here at Parliament, one of the debates is who is the next Speaker of Parliament. You have an NUP that says we were cheated out of the election. President Yoweri Museveni cheated us of our victory. You have party members that are saying we are going to support the third in command of Yoweri Kaguta Museveni. So that means on the onset, you're bound to collide.
I will tell you for a fact that hitherto, until about a month ago, before we had the first meeting with our members were speaking out of turn. And I am very sure, if you really follow, we have since called the caucus to order. Secondly, make no mistake, NUP is very much interested in who becomes the next Speaker of Parliament and Deputy. We are very much interested. We are keenly following. We are smartly planning. We shall participate in choosing the next Speaker.
If you're interested, I would say you're a suitable candidate for running for
Speaker. The problem for you is that interest means candidature. Interest necessarily is not candidature. Interest could be deciding who becomes Speaker. So we are into this, including deciding to have a candidate. The beauty about choosing a Speaker is that you don't need posters. I'm sure we have no illiterate members of Parliament. In a single meeting, we can determine who the Speaker is. So you know, we don't have to make a lot of noise about it. I am very sure, of course, I know some members come here with other people's academic document, but I'm sure even those are literate enough to make a decision in a single day or a week. So make no mistake, we are interested and we shall make a decision. But we are not reckless to simply speak out of turn. We are considering all manner of options at our disposal to have a candidate, to have one, to have both, to work with others. All these are political permutations we are looking at. You know, we are not in a hurry. We are not scared that we are late. No, we are not late. We are not worried that it can be taken away from us. No, we are interested and we shall determine the next Speaker.
Then that poses a question. I mean, you had a retreat and everyone expected that you would come out with an answer. What happened at the retreat? What was your nature of discussion about this, your interest in the speakership while in Jinja, and what did you resolve?
We discussed the matter of the Speaker and we resolved to move as I have explained, to explore options and be exploring them. Even now, I've been in a meeting over the same matter. We shall have several meetings. Can I tell you? We shall inform the country when we are ready.
And on the small matter of the leader of opposition?
Yes. No, the leader of opposition is not a small matter. It's a very big matter because the leader of opposition
I call it small because it's up to the NUP leadership to decide.
No, it's not small, because then the leader of opposition is a frontline leader for the entire opposition coalition in parliament. So we discussed it. The beauty is that the party constitution is very unequivocal on how it is determined. So it shall be determined when the time comes. I'm very sure the party is undertaking consultations over the matter. It should not cause any ulcers. It shall be determined.
Naively, I'll ask, what does your constitution say about determining this kind of position?
We have a party organ called the executive board. It will determine.
It will determine.
Yes.
Okay. Moving on. You brought a matter on the floor of parliament. It's a matter of national concern. The issue of opposition supporters that have been either detained or quote-unquote abducted or kidnapped. Some are laying before the court martial. Others are in Chitalia. Others are in Luzira. The Minister of Internal Affairs has been here on two occasions. One, first admitting that on the list that you presented of, I think, 423 supporters, I think 50 have either been remanded or are laying before courts, that kind of thing, while about 300 plus people are unaccounted for. Where are we on this matter?
On the day the minister returned to parliament, the Honorable Mwanga Chivumbi, our shadow minister for internal affairs, did ask the speaker to give us time to audit the minister's presentation. And we are through. I'm very sure on the order paper, the matter should be there. There's a response from our side on that matter, and the Honorable Mwanga Chivumbi will headline it on our behalf. But for the rest of the citizens, it should be a big worry that a government can even be coming around to explain that doesn't know what's happened to its citizens. Beyond the politics, why would a government abduct and kill citizens because there's been a political disagreement? Why would a party in power abuse this mandate? The mandate of any party in power, for beginners, is protection of citizens. When citizens are on the run, so what are you actually running? Are you running a government or a militia? So these questions must concern all of us. They are not a matter of NUP or the opposition for that matter. I'll tell you, on the day the EC announced General Museveni winner, without figures, in one of the towns near to Masaka City, citizens were being chased to go home because General Museveni has been announced to winner. And in the ensuing shootout, the military shot a lady and her child, and they were both NRM supporters. Think about it. So is this about the opposition? It's about justice. It's about freedom. It's about understanding. So I want to invite the country, everyone, every sober human being, to be concerned that a government can descend on its people and terrorize them. It's not the business of the opposition. The shootings have been properly enumerated by the different media houses. And the people they have shot, for the bigger part, are ordinary citizens. So all of us must be concerned. So we await the response when the Honorable Chivumbi presents on our behalf.
The government has given its justification for these arrests, what you call abductions and kidnaps. But we are going to discuss the merits and demerits of those justifications when we return from the break.